Square, and it's good to be back home, and we're excited to have a live service, and we are grateful that we're able to do this. And of course, there are those still watching through live stream, so we're glad that they are able to offer that and participate in that way. It seems like it's been forever since we've seen each other. It's been at least a couple months, so we're glad to be here together, and we're going to be as respectful of our space as we can and enjoy fellowship together and the worship and the singing of God's Word, the reading of God's Word, and the preaching of God's Word, and we'll enjoy a beautiful Sunday together. I'll give you a little more information during the announcement time, kind of what we're doing moving forward, how we're going to operate as a church, and then a little update as to what I've been up to for those of you that don't know as well, and we'll get into that as well. So let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll join with the worship team in singing this morning. Lord, we're thankful for how good you are. Thank you, Lord, for the ability to come here and physically meet together, and we're grateful for that. And Lord, I pray that you would just bless and protect us, Lord. I pray that we would be wise in how we interact with one another. But I also pray, Lord, that you would bless our time together physically. Be with those that are watching through live stream, Lord, and we pray that you would encourage their hearts and bless them, Lord. We're thankful for them as well, and we are so glad that they're able to meet with us in that way. Lord, we also pray that you'd be with our country this morning. There's a lot of things going on, from the virus, Lord, to various social unrest. We ask, Lord, that you would bless and protect where needed there. I pray that you would encourage our nation, Lord, to return to you. We ask you to be with the service this morning. We pray that you would, Lord, empower the worship team as they lead us in worship this morning. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be free from distraction. We'd be encouraged and blessed. Lead us into a heart of worship this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, how are we doing this morning? This isn't quite normal yet, is it? But we're getting there. We're heading in that direction. You know, someone said, there's no place like home. And it's good. It's good that the people that we call brothers and sisters in the faith, that we can get together. Amen. I've got a new appreciation for the privilege we have of our meetings. Mm. And for those who, for whatever reason, can't regularly get together, whether that's persecution, whether that's sicknesses, but wow, last couple months have really given me another perspective. I hope you're ready to sing this morning. Can you stand? Can you put your hands together this morning? Can you look heavenward, at least with your heart, and say, God, you are good, and we want to bless your name this morning. We want to praise your name. Amen. Amen. Let's do it.
Amen.
I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation, and it's beautiful.
There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's a real gospel song. Once you choose it,
steal my got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
Put your hands together for the Lord this morning. Awesome singing.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Whom the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child.
Are you a child of the God this morning? Put your hands together. Raise your hand. Raise your hand if you're a child of the King. Amen. Amen.
No heat. that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you here on this earth. And I will fear no evil.
Shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, never let go every high and every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord, never let go of me. See light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you. Still I will praise you.
We're going to pick up where we left off about 2.5 months ago. We had just introduced this song, and we really never had a chance for congregation to learn it. Maybe you guys have heard it on the radio, but let's sing about the sweetness of God's forgiveness. I mean, that's why we're here this morning, because we are a forgiven people. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will not hold against him. Amen?
Amen.
Let's try it. 2, 3, 4.
Again, God, I'm begging, please again, I need you. Oh, I need you. Water for the desert roads, and water for my thirsty soul, I need you. Oh, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of the symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. Dead man walking, slave to sin. I want to know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you. So take me to the riverside. Take me under, baptize. I need you. Oh God, I need you. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like a
like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water, your forgiveness. It's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony to my ears. Like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water.
Father, this morning, yes, yes, go ahead, give it up for the Lord. We want to bless you, Lord, that you saw something in us worth saving. Lord, I don't understand that, but we accept your grace. We receive it with hearts that are humbled and yet full of joy. And Lord, I just want to thank you that by your grace we can meet here today. And Lord, I pray that by your power, Lord, that you would make this a step towards some kind of normalcy for us as believers, as a country, as a world. Lord, we have been humbled. We have been humbled by this pandemic, understanding that it is beyond us to fix. Lord, we look to you. We look to you this morning, and I just pray that we would be encouraged in our faith this morning, by the songs that we sing, by the word that will be broken, by the fellowship that we will share. Lord, I pray that you'd have your way here, that you would plant seeds, that you would water them. Oh, Lord, that you would bring to fruition your will. And Lord, we praise you this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor.
All right, as I mentioned when we started, it's good to see everybody, and it's been a while, and it's exciting to be back together, but there's, as you can see, a lot of differences to what we're doing right now, and there's going to be some continual differences as we get going, and kind of not just how we operate, but the schedule that we're operating with. As you've noticed, the chairs are spread out more. The fellowship time that we normally enjoy right after I give my spiel right here, is on hold for now. So what we're going to do in the coming weeks until things kind of normalize a little bit more is after we do the singing, we'll have some announcements, and then we'll take like a 2 or 3 minute break for people to use the restroom if they need to. And we ask that we'd be as delicate as possible with trying to maintain our distance where we can. So if you, in a moment when we're done with the announcement time, if you need to use the facility, we'll play a song over the speakers. You can stand up, stretch your legs, use the facility if you need to, and we'll come right back in for our scripture reading and the sermon portion of the service. So the service will be a little bit shorter than it typically is, probably roughly about an hour. I've said this before, most people don't complain about shorter sermons and shorter services. So we'll have a good time together, and we're excited to see everybody here physically. I hope everyone's been doing well. And also kind of an interesting thing, I guess it's been about 2.5 months since we met together. And most everyone, I'm sure this isn't new news to anybody, but basically 2 weeks after we stopped having services, I was activated with National Guard and brought down to Massachusetts, and basically, with the exception of about 4 days, was there the entire time. So Chuck has been holding down the fort for us and preaching with all of his other responsibilities that he has. He's taken on these responsibilities too, and we owe him a great debt of gratitude for what he's done for our church. So we're very thankful for that and everything that he's done and the sacrifices he's made. And it's been an interesting time for everybody. I hope, and I haven't heard reports of people that are really without work when it comes to this in our congregation. I know there's a lot of people in various communities that have been without work, and we're praying for those people that that gets restored quickly. And if you would have said 2.5 months ago what we'd be dealing with, I don't think anyone could even really imagine that. I didn't have any frame of reference to imagine, going to a Walmart and going through this a maze of this labyrinth of carts and one-way aisles and masks and all the things that we're dealing with now that have become somewhat the new normal. That's very different than anything we've experienced. And if you haven't been able to, and probably haven't or shouldn't travel much outside the state of Maine, we are blessed in Maine to not have been as affected both by the virus and by the collateral damage of the closings and all the things that have happened. It's very interesting how things work. One, if you want to say positive thing that's happened, is every day that I drove, I basically drove through Boston with zero traffic, so that was nice. But there was absolutely nobody on the road, so that was interesting. But where most of, kind of update what I did and what I've been doing with the information I can give you, we got activated. Some units were there to assist with supplies. Some units were there to assist with where it started pretty much in Massachusetts was the Veterans Home in Holyoke, and a lot of the people went out there to clean up and do those things. My unit was tasked with doing testing, so we were tasked with doing the COVID tests, and it's an interesting thing that I can tell you more about after the service if you want to know that. But we tested, I was one of the testers, so I had the little swabs, and people would ask me when I came in there, we're in full suit, you can only see our eyes, we had the face shields on, masks, all this stuff, and they'd say, do you do medicine with the military? I said, no, actually, we're field artillery. We shoot cannons, but here it comes, all right? it was interesting. We had a day course on how to do this, and then we performed thousands of them. So I think the armory that we were out of, the general that came and spoke to us said that we had performed the third highest number of tests of anyone in the state. It had been like 15,000 tests that we performed. Normally, it was about 200 a day, so we were doing all that. Now that I've terrified all of you that I've been around sick people, we also had to get tested as well. So I received my test last week, and that was not fun. So if you have ever had a flu test, it's the same idea. And it's not a pleasant experience, but it's also not the end of the world either. So that was that. And today technically is my last day on military orders. So barring some disaster that happens, I'll be here now for the coming days, and we're looking forward to that. As a way also, I posted, as many of you know, I don't have Facebook, so I don't have a personal page, so I posted using Cherish's account yesterday about our service information, and I recognize that not everyone uses Facebook or social media, so I meant to have it prepared today, and I simply forgot, and I'll have it prepared next week. I would like to have us update some of our contact information, and the reason I say that is we do have some older lists. But I can post something on Facebook using Cherish's account, and I realize that still puts a burden on some of you to contact people that don't have Facebook. So what I'd like to do, and I apologize for not having it ready this Sunday, but have just simply a card of how you want to be contacted for changes. Now, this isn't going to be, you know, spam mail type of things. This is going to be service changes, emergency announcements, those types of things, and you'll just simply check Facebook's how you want to be contacted, or email, and then if you say email, provide your email address, because I probably don't have it, and then phone number, assume I don't have that either, and provide that as well. If you check none of the three, then that's fine too. You just won't get firsthand information from me, all right? So I'm not offended if you say I don't want you having any of my personal information. That's okay, all right? You'll just not hear from me. But that's something that I'll have ready by next week, because I realize we're kind of trying to figure out how we can communicate with people, especially in the coming weeks when things may change some. Hopefully, Lord willing, sooner rather than later, we'll be back to full speed. But I would count on this being the new normal for at least the time being. Encourage those that couldn't be here this morning and reach out to them, because I know that's going to be important that they have contact and that you're encouraging them as well. So what we're going to do now is just take a really quick break, and this is going to be, like I said, 2 or 3 minutes long. You don't even have to go anywhere if you don't want to. You can stand up, stretch your legs. He's going to play a song. If you need to use the bathroom, you can, and we'll get back started here in a minute. Tom will come up and read the scripture passage, and that's how we'll start the service again. So again, if you need to stretch your legs, get some fresh air, whatever you feel like you need to do, you can stay put if you want to. Just about 2 or 3 minutes, and we'll get started.
The first 8 verses of James, and then we're going to do one in Revelations as well. But I'll get started here. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. And then the next is going to be from Revelations chapter 2, verses 8 through 11, to the church in Smyrna. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write the words of the first and the last who died and came to life. I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death.
All right, thank you, Tom. Let's pray before we start the message. Lord, we're thankful for your word as it's been read and spoken to us, Lord. We are asking, God, that you would challenge our hearts this morning with the reading of your word. Lord, we've already been challenged with the singing of your word. And now we ask, God, that you would just challenge us with the preaching of your word. Help us, Lord, to understand what the text says. Help us to apply it to our lives. Encourage us this morning as we've already been encouraged. We ask that these things in Christ's name. Amen. So as you go into the second passage here that he read, Revelation chapter number 2, if you were able to view the service online last week, you heard the first part of this. And if you were not, I'm going to refresh it anyways, just in case you're unable to, or you simply didn't want to, whatever the case was. If you didn't get it last week, you'll get a little bit of it this week anyways. But Revelation chapter 2 is kind of the beginning of the letters that John, who is the author of the book of Revelation, is giving to these seven churches. And this is the word of Christ to these churches, and this is his instruction and his encouragement to them. And as you read these, if you've ever studied the book of Revelation, if you've been in church for any number of years, you probably heard maybe a few messages on the book of Revelation. I mentioned last week that when I preached on the church of Ephesus, that's probably only the third message I've ever preached from the book of Revelation. Now, there's a few different reasons for that. One of the reasons would be that sometimes the book of Revelation is confusing. You read it, there's a lot of symbolism, there's a lot of things that are not easily understood. And then there's also a lot of poor teaching about the book of Revelation. Most of the people, if you were to say, what do you know about Revelation? Your mind's going to go to that extreme person who maybe predicts when Jesus is coming back. The end is near, people. You always have these people. I remember, and I've always followed this with some intrigue, when people are like, all right, in 1980, Jesus is going to return. And then 1980 obviously rolls around, and Jesus didn't return. And then he makes an adjustment. Oh, I've got my calculations wrong. And it's like, I don't know what you're calculating. But this continually happens, and it's amazing. People will follow that. They'll still read that. Or if you are around my age, you'll probably remember the Left Behind series that became really popular, the books. And I remember reading those as a teenager, and the sudden rapture of the church and all the things that go along with that, and people being left behind and having to live through the tribulation. And then I remember preachers that would preach. I remember this one preacher came and he preached a prophecy message. And this was a big deal back in the day, having like a revival meeting, had themes every night, and they'd preach, and all right, and then make sure you bring your lost friends because Friday night is prophecy night. And now looking back on that, I was like, that's definitely the worst night to bring your lost friends. And I remember hearing this preacher preach, and then he said, all right, turn off the cameras, turn off the audio. We were in this big old-fashioned tent, And he gets up and he says, now I want to say something off the record. I really believe that the Lord is coming back and tribulation is starting any moment. And he said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go home. You think, I can tell by your face, you're like, is this a real story? This is 100% real. All right. And he says, all right, go home. And I want you to plant a garden, the biggest garden you can plant. He said, because the Bible talks about, you know, loaves of bread costing this and that. He said, the end is coming and you are going to need that food to feed your family. And I'm sitting here in the front row as the assistant pastor at this church thinking, this is crazy. So I go and the pastor said, what do you think of the message? I said, let me ask you a question. If the world is starving and they find out that I have a garden, what do you think is going to happen to me? All right, I'm not doing any of that stuff. All right, I remember it's the same thing when Y2K happened. Remember everyone is hoarding, you know, root vegetables and cans of beans? And as soon as all of that happened, I remember New Year's Eve, my best friend in all the world, he comes and he tells me, he said, I'm really sad for your family. I said, why is that? He said, because your dad has saved no food whatsoever, and you guys are going to starve. And I was thinking, yeah, I don't really, my dad was one of these people, no, he wouldn't even go to the grocery store. No, we're not buying, we don't need beans. There are probably people to this day still eating beans from the year 1999, all right? But as you have these trials that come up and these things about Revelation, one thing that you should understand when you read the book of Revelation is this was written to churches. This was meant to encourage them that, yes, there is going to be coming a time where God judges the wickedness of earth, but the encouragement is to the church that as the church, you don't have to be a direct part of that. It's an encouragement that although you're going to go through persecution and trial and all these things, you, God, will be merciful to because you took care of business now. And here as he's writing these seven churches, one of the confusing things that happens with this story is that you hear a lot of people that will say these seven churches represent seven church ages. That's what I heard all growing up. Now, there is some similarities, and it could potentially be right, but that's not specifically what Scripture says. So if the Bible says this is an age, we'll call it an age, but the truth is the Bible talks about seven physical churches, and as you do this, there are seven churches. It's Ephesus, it's Smyrna, which we're talking about today, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And the way that John writes this, Jesus gives them a specific message. He says, here's what I want you to tell them. I'm going to give you something good. This is what they did good. I'm going to give you something bad. This is what they did wrong. And then I'm going to tell you the instruction, how they need to fix it. So as he deals with this, each of these seven churches have a different problem. All but two have direct problems. And as we deal with this, I'm going to tell you how you're going to fix it. Now, if these were seven church ages, it does make sense. The first one, Church of Ephesus, experienced a lot of amazing things, and then what, as we learned last week, it says, I know your deeds, your hard works, your perseverance, but if you remember the church of Ephesus, most people remember two. They remember Ephesus and Laodicea. Ephesus, you left your first love. You were in love with God. You did all these things out of the good things of your heart. He said, but you left it behind. You forgot about it. You still kept the work, but you forgot about the love. And I would say that's probably true of a lot of churches that start the right way. If we're not careful, you start the right way and you kind of dull your sense of love. Have you ever noticed that if you've grown up in church your whole life, it may be if you were like me, I remember as a kid getting basically dragged to church, and I remember thinking like, oh, please, this is the most boring thing ever. And you sing the songs and you sit there and be like, oh, I don't want to sing. And then the preacher, I was the kid that got in trouble all the time sitting there trying to make my siblings laugh, or I'd pinch one of them. So like you have those things that are going on and you think, oh, church really is just church. But that person who didn't grow up in church and they come to Christ later, there's like that excitement. And you notice it, that's infectious excitement about being a new follower of Christ. Why? Because they have that fresh love. Now, it's a challenge for us as experienced believers, if you will, to rekindle that love for God. Yeah, we still do the good works, but let's keep the love. So Ephesus, if this was in church age, would be the beginning of the church. Then we have Smyrna, and we talk about how this is the persecuted church. He says, hey, listen, there's all these things that are happening. I understand your afflictions and your poverty. If this was a church age, this would be that persecuted church in the first and second century, the Fox Book of Martyrs type church, where people were literally being persecuted. And this is the time frame in which Revelation was written. So when John is writing to this church, they were experiencing intense persecution. Now, As we've gone through all of what we're going through with the COVID-19 crisis, the pandemic, and we as the church have tried very specifically to not be out of the way according to what the governor wants us to do. So we've tried to do very well at that. But there are people, and there are people that will say, especially in other areas of the country, that they're being persecuted as a church. And I have a couple responses to that. Some of them I'll share, some of them I won't. One of the ones I'll share is that's not the same level of persecution that this church is experiencing. And the second thing is everyone was closed down, so it wasn't targeting churches in those instances for the most part. So here, as we're talking about persecution, we're not talking about your coworker laughing because you're a Christian. We're not talking about your school kids saying, oh, you believe in God. This was persecution that resulted in death. This was persecution that resulted in imprisonment. This was persecution that resulted in people being unable to be employed. These are real, legitimate persecutions. But then the third church is Pergamos, and this is a church that grew, and this would be the age of Constantine if you did the ages. And Thyatira, this would be a corrupted church that would signify the age of the church under Rome. And then you have Sardis, this would be the feeble, growing church. This would be like Protestant Reformation era church. And then you have Philadelphia. This was the church that experienced love. This was the growing church. And then you have, of course, Laodicea, which is the lukewarm church. And we all know the passage where it says, I'll spew you out of my mouth because you're neither hot nor cold. And of course, modern day preachers will say that's the age we're living in today. And just to move on, not to belabor this point, my personal opinion is this is not talking about church ages. And the reason I say that is because he's talking to specific churches. And all of these things can be true of any individual church in the day that we're living in today. There are churches, we look at it from America's standpoint, oh, we're Laodicea because we're lukewarm. But then you go to another country and they may be getting intense persecution. So I don't believe this is a specific age so much as it is a church and an admonition to us to watch our heart and how we live as a church. So let's get right into this church here in chapter number 2 and verse number 8. We talked about last week kind of the format. He gives his approval, he gives his accusation, and then he admonishes them to do something better. But then the other thing that we see here is that there's a specific title which Jesus goes by. The church of Ephesus, he says what? To this angel of the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. Now in the chapter 2, verse 8, he says, these are the words of him who is first and last, who died and came to life again. Why is he telling them this? He's about to show these people who had experienced persecution, hey, I died and came to life again. There's resurrection after death. Now to us, that means only a little bit because we don't really face imminent death. But if you're experiencing any moment you could be put to death for your faith, that encouragement of Christ saying, listen, I've been there, done that, and you will rise again with me. He's encouraging them. And then notice what he says here. I know your afflictions. In each of these seven churches, as he gives the good things that they're doing, he says, I know. Why? He's saying, it's not lost on me that you're doing good works. I know that you're doing the right thing in these cases. Sometimes you feel like when you're doing the right thing that nobody notices. I'm just working alone and I'm doing the right thing and I'm trying to do it for the right motives, but it would be nice if someone recognizes my hard work. Maybe a job at work, you have a boss who just does not recognize your hard work. Or worse yet, if you ever had a boss who recognizes your hard work, but then takes credit for it himself. All right, and here it's nice to know sometimes when you have somebody that says, I know you're a good worker. I know that you're doing the right thing. I know that you're working hard. And here Christ is saying, I know what? He says, I know your afflictions. I know your poverty, yet you are rich. I know about the slanders of them who say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. He says, I know what you're going through. He says, you're going through persecution. Then notice there's three things he mentions here. I know your trials. I know you're being afflicted. Now, what trials were they going through? They were being persecuted primarily for not giving in to Caesar, for not worshiping him. And they said, because you didn't follow Caesar, you're going to be persecuted. But they were being tortured and they were being put to death. But also he says, look here, I know what they say of those who are Jews, but they're not really Jews. What is he saying here? He said, there's a large Jewish community, and they say, well, we are still Jewish, and these are the followers of Caesar, but you're a Christian. You don't belong to either party. It's kind of like you don't fit in anywhere. I don't know how you feel. There are sometimes as a Christian, I feel like I don't fit in anywhere. You have those that are anti-God. You have those that just really don't believe in God at all or don't care about God. And if you try to stand up for what's right, sometimes it feels like I really don't fit in. Maybe when you got saved, all of a sudden your friends kind of slowly started disappearing. Maybe when you started doing the right thing and not going to the same old places you used to go, maybe those contacts and those friendships that you used to have kind of started slowly going away. Maybe even your family didn't understand, and it's slowly starting, and it feels like I am completely out of place. And here Christ is saying, I know. I know what you're going through. I know your trials. But then also he says, I know your poverty. And we'll be getting to James chapter 1 in a moment, but he says, I know your poverty. He said, I know how much you're going through. Why were they impoverished? Because they couldn't work. They were outcasts. They were blackballed from society. They were physically and financially poor. And go in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians, if you will. 2 Corinthians. He says, I know your poverty, but then also he says something interesting. He says, I know your poverty, but also what? Yet you are rich. You are rich. You say, well, that doesn't make any sense if they're poor. Obviously, we know where we're heading with this, that it's not talking about financial wealth. But look at 2 Corinthians chapter number 6 and verse number 3. We put no stumbling block in anyone's path so that our ministry will not be discredited. Now, that's an interesting thing. We'll stop. I don't want to get too hung up on this, but I believe as a church, we ought to do the best we can. The Bible says, render unto Caesar's the things that are Caesar's. What does that mean? That means, like, what were they talking about? They're talking about paying taxes. I know a pastor, actually, not personally, but he had all these DVDs, and he had this large ministry. And I remember we had to watch him as teenagers, and I was never really super into it because it was about things that I didn't, not that I didn't care about, but I didn't necessarily, wasn't as exciting to me, things like dinosaurs and stuff like that. I never really gave much interest in that. But as he's doing this, and he's doing these videos, he suddenly was off the scene. Where'd he go? He's nowhere to be found. This guy's ministry is over. And turns out he didn't like paying taxes. And he owed the government hundreds of thousands of dollars. And he owed all this money and went to jail for like 9 years. He says, as a Christian, I don't have to pay to an evil government. Well, that's not what Jesus says. Jesus said, render to Caesar things that are Caesar's. Notice what 2 Corinthians is saying. I put no stumbling block in anyone's path so our ministry will not be discredited. I believe as a church that if we were to face persecution where we actually did have to stand up against the direct order, we would do that. But where possible, I believe Christians ought to do their best to live civilly with their government and to live civilly with authority. I believe that's the right thing. And here's why, because you don't want to be discredited. You don't want to be that church that's like, oh, that's that rebel church, or that's that strange church. We want to make sure that the gospel is not affected negatively by our actions. But rather, he says, verse 4, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way, the great endurance in trouble and hardships and distress and beatings, imprisonments and riots and hard work, sleepless nights and hunger, and in purity, understanding, patience, kindness, in the Holy Spirit, in sincere love, in truthful speech. He said, we're setting the example in these things, in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in our right hand and our left, through glory and dishonor, bad report, good report, genuine yet regarded as impostors, known yet regarded as unknown, dying yet we live on, beaten yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making many rich, having nothing and possessing everything. You know what? You hear people say money isn't everything. You hear all these phrases, money can't buy happiness. There's two observations I have for those things. Money can't buy happiness is normally spoken by people with no money. All right? All right, so money can't buy happiness, all right? The truth is money cannot buy peace. Money cannot buy the condition of your soul. Can money buy happiness? To a certain measure, it absolutely can. All right, have you ever had a nice meal and been happy? Money paid for that. Have you ever bought a new car and been happy? Of course. The idea behind what the Bible is talking about when it comes to money, the love of money is the root of all evil, not money. It's okay to have money. It's okay to save. It's okay to spend on nice things. It's okay. Those are things that God blesses us with. And the truth is, money doesn't buy soul happiness. But here he's saying, we have no money. This is not, we're going through a tough time. These are people without jobs. These are people that are starving to death. And he said, yet, what does Christ say? They are rich. Rich and poor, small and great, stand before God. The judgment seat of Christ is the great equalizer. You can be the most important man in the world or the most overlooked person on the face of the earth. And when you stand before God, it's all the same. What an amazing God we serve that doesn't judge us based on what we have, but based on the condition of our hearts. And here he's telling the church of Sardis, they were a poor church, a persecuted church. He said, I'm not judging you based on what you can do. I'm judging you based on what's in your heart. And here they were in poverty. He said, and I know your worship. I know that you resisted those religious leaders of the day. But let's move on to the nature of our trial. The nature of our trial. Go to James chapter 1 if you can. Tom read it earlier. James chapter 1, a very familiar passage of scripture talking about trials. You know what's interesting about the Bible? The Bible tells us that trials will come. If you say, I've never had a hard time in my life, I would say you're probably a liar. All right? I've never had a hard thing in my life. Now, what's the difference between trials and temptation in the Bible? James actually gives us that. Now, the word temptation is sometimes interchangeable with trial, but the difference is a trial comes from externally, all right? So a trial would be you become ill. That's a trial. You lose your job. That's a trial. A sick family member, that's a trial. Emotional distress, that's a trial. But a temptation is something that's born out of the sinful nature of our hearts, all right? If you are tempted to look at something you shouldn't or say something you shouldn't, that's not something that God puts in your heart. God may try you, but God does not tempt us to sin, all right? If you said, well, you hear people that commit crimes all the time, well, God told me to do that. He did not. God does not tell us to violate his word. But he does try us sometimes. And here James chapter number 1 verse 2 says, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kind. You're going to face trial. The nature of trial is you're going to face it. Did anyone see the trial of our global pandemic coming? Maybe a few people had inside information, but nobody could have recognized this trial. But here we are. We're in a trial, some more than others. Some experience loss of life. Some experience loss of jobs and income. Some have been separated from families. We've all had trials. They will come. But there's three levels to trials. I'm going to give you these very quickly. Three levels of trial. Number one is the human level of trial. Sometimes you have trials because of other people. Sometimes you have trials because of a bad employer or a difficult person to deal with. Sometimes you have trouble and trials at school because of a bully. Or maybe you have troubles and trials as a kid because you get picked on by your brother or your sister. You have trials. You encounter these things. My younger siblings would probably say I was a source of their trial, all right? You have trials that come from people. There's a human nature to trial. And as long as people exist, you're going to have conflict. You're going to have conflict with people. And some more than others. Have you ever met somebody that you just simply don't like? We all have. No one likes to admit it. I openly admit it, all right? But you meet someone and you're instantly, you don't even know this person. You're like, I don't like that person. All right? I don't know why. It's just this feeling that you get. And I am someone that I'm quick to judge and rely on my gut instincts. And I had this conversation with somebody a few weeks back. When was the last time you had this gut instinct feeling like, I don't like that person? And then later you had to say, you know what? I was wrong. That person wasn't that bad. Some of you are saying, never. I'm still don't like him, all right? Maybe that's how you feel, and sometimes that's how I feel as well. But you have these instincts. Sometimes you just have human conflict, and you can't even explain it. There are human trials. There are people that have lost their jobs for no reasons. That's a human trial that you can't control that's caused by another person. But there's also a second trial, and that's satanic trial. The Bible talks about in Revelation, he says what? That you're going to be put in prison by the devil. Now, a lot of people like to blame the devil for things that I'm not so sure the devil directly does. All right, everyone's heard the expression, the devil made me do it? Not so sure. The devil may have influenced you to do it, but you are still in control of your actions, last I checked. And here, as we face trial, you are going to be tempted by the devil. And some of these trials come from the devil. You remember the story of Job? You say, well, God tried him. Job tried him under the permission of God. I mean, the devil tried Job under the permission of God. So the devil does tempt and try us. When we go through a trial, you know what's one good thing to do? Remind ourselves, all right, Lord, is there something in my life that you want to change? Is there something in my life that needs corrected? Help me. Help me see that. And sometimes the answer is no. Sometimes he's just trying to grow us. There's human trial. There's satanic trial. But there's also divine trial. God does sometimes try us. The Bible says in James chapter number 1, consider it all joy, my brothers, when you fall into trials of many kind, because knowing that the testing of your faith, what, produces patience or perseverance. And verse 4, let perseverance finish its work so you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. The Bible tells us when it comes to trial, testing produces perseverance, and perseverance produces perfection. And here's what the Bible's telling us, that as we go through these testing and trials, the first thing that we normally do is, how quick can I get out of this? How quick can I get this over with? If you're like me, I am someone that has a very short attention span. All right, my wife gets on me, we'll play a song, I'll be like, hey, listen to this new song I heard. I'll go through like the first 30 seconds of it and change it. It's a horrible habit. I don't listen, like movies, I can't do movies. I watch a movie for a little while, like, oh, that's boring, and it's on to the next thing. All right, you finish, like I've started probably 25 books in the last month, finished none of them. All right, so as we go through some of these things, we're so quick to get out of these trials that sometimes we miss the whole reason we're in the trial. We're so much praying, God, get me out of the trial, God, get me out of the trial, that we are forgetting, Lord, why am I sitting here in this right now? What is it that you're trying to teach me? Yes, Lord, I want out, but also help me to learn something from this. God wants us to experience this time of testing to produce perseverance. But lastly, and we're done, look at James chapter 1, verse number 12. He says this, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood that test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. Remember the end of the passage that he was talking to this church at Smyrna? He says, you persevere and you're getting the crown of life. This is that victor's crown that's given for those that overcome. Not the most talented, not the most intelligent or the richest, not the poorest, but the person who overcomes. You know the great thing about Christianity is God doesn't measure you based on your talent. He doesn't. The world measures you based on your talents, based on your performance. But God doesn't measure you that way. Remember the story of the talents? The guy that had the 5, the guy that had the 2, the guy that had the 1, and how they have all these things and difference in talents. The man that had the 1 and buried it in the sand was not judged because he only had 1 talent. He was judged because he didn't do anything with what God gave him. And the truth is, as believers, some of us, have you ever met someone who's just good at everything? Those are the kind of people we don't like so much. We're like, oh yeah, you're good at everything. Congratulations. All right, look at me, I can read. You know, that kind of thing. So, and here, as you have these people that are good at everything, and you sometimes say, oh, I'm not very good at this, so I won't serve. Oh, you know what? I can't sing like the worship band can sing, so I can't speak in public. And some of these things you do, and you say, well, I can't do that. And you say, well, I just won't do anything. Well, maybe we can. I couldn't sing like that. But there's something I can do. Maybe you don't want to speak in public, but there's something you can do. There's something that we can use and serve. And what does the Bible say? And the crown of life to those that overcome. What an amazing thing. God encourages us, and he encourages this church, as we go through trials, as we go through persecution, patiently look for the purpose of these trials and understand that there's a reward for those that overcome. Let's pray. Lord, we do thank you for how good you are, and we love you. Lord, thank you that we were able to meet today, and as we are beginning to wrap up the service, Lord, it's been a blessing just to be around other believers, just physically be around each other, Lord. It's something that we've missed, and we're thankful for it. Lord, in light of being around each other, Lord, I pray that we'd continue to be diligent to be safe and healthy, and I pray that you'd protect all of our community and those that are trying to restart businesses, Lord. I'm particularly concerned for those that, you know, have lost incomes. I pray that you would just bless them, Lord, help them to endure this trial, Lord. And we're not just praying for believers, Lord. We're praying for believers and unbelievers alike. We ask that you would just bless. Lord, I pray that you'd be with us in this service at the end as we close. Help us understand that you want to reward endurance and reward overcoming. Lord, help us to do that, to patiently persevere, Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
as we're thinking about praising the Lord, I'm the one that doesn't like to speak in public. God laid on my heart this chapter in Psalms, and it's not 119, it's Psalm 150. Praise the Lord, praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and the organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high-sounding cymbals. And verse number 6 is the song that we're going to be singing next. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord.
Let everything that, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise you in the morning, praise you in the evening, praise when I'm young and when I'm old. Praise when I'm laughing, praise when I'm grieving. Praise you every season of the soul. We could see how much your word, your power, your might, your endless love. Surely we could never cease to praise him. Let everything that, everything that has breath praise. Could see how much your word, your power, your might, your endless love. Surely we would never cease to pray. Everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Oh, we praise your name. Singing with the angels, joining with creation, yeah.
We could see how much your word, your power, your might, your endless love, surely
persons to praise. We praise your name. Let everything that, everything that, everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that, everything that, everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Oh, praise the Lord.
We're going to close the service in a word of prayer, and it's good to see everyone here again. Reach out to someone that maybe you know wasn't able to come today and just tell them that you missed them, and just be in kind of in tune for more information as things change kind of rapidly, and hopefully we'll be able to update you as much as we possibly can. So let's pray, and we'll dismiss with the Lord's blessing. Lord, we're again grateful, and Lord, we do praise you, and this whole earth speaks of your praise. And we ask, Lord, that you would help us as we celebrate this beautiful Lord's Day, with a living reminder, Lord, of how wonderful you've been to us. In spite of kind of chaos around us, Lord, you have given us a place of shelter here in our church where we can worship you with a pure heart and a pure mind. Send us forth with your blessing. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.